Okay, in continuation with last class, let us discuss automatic load frequency control. So in this automatic load frequency control, ALFC, it is to control the frequency deviation by maintaining the real power balance in the system. So main function of ALFC, automatic load frequency control, are to maintain the steady frequency, control tie line power flows, distribute load among participating generating units. Okay, the control input signals are tie line deviation, delta P tie, measured from tie line flows, and frequency deviation, delta F, obtained by measuring the angle deviation delta delta. So these errors, the frequency deviation and tie line power, are amplified, mixed, and transformed to a real power signal, which controls the valve position. So depending on the valve position, the turbine changes its output power to establish real power balance. Okay, so here always you need to monitor this delta F and delta P type. So schematic diagram for ALFC, you can observe here the generator. There is a feedback from the coupling point of generator and turbine to the governor. The governor is sending signal to the valve or gate position. In turn, it has an input of steam water input connected to the turbine. So using swing equation, this swing equation you will be learning, you might have learned in your PSA, swing equation. Okay, so here delta PM is small change in mechanical power, delta P is small change in electrical power, is dependent on your change in angle as well as your frequency. So the derivative of change in angle, change in speed, is expressed in terms of the equation d delta w by dt is equal to 1 by 2h into delta pm minus delta pe. So the block diagram representation for generator. Okay, input powers, delta PM, small change in mechanical power input, small change in electrical power input, delta PM minus delta PE is equal to dy. This equation only we are representing in the block diagram form. This equation, please note down. D delta W by dt is equal to 1 by 2h into delta PM minus delta PE. So Laplace transform, in the block diagram, you are representing in Laplace transform. So Laplace transform of derivative term is S into delta WS. So this S you are bringing to this side, you will get in the denominator. So the load on the system is composite. Composite in the sense it is complex. Okay, consisting of frequency independent component and frequency dependent component. The load can be written as a delta P is equal to delta P naught plus delta PF. Delta P is change in load. Delta P naught is frequency independent load component. Delta PF is frequency dependent load component, where delta PF is represented as D into delta W, where D is called frequency characteristic of the load or damping constant, which is expressed as percentage change in load for 1% change in frequency. So that is, if D is equal to 1.5%, then 1% change in frequency causes 1.5% change in load. The combined generator and load can be represented like this. Okay, in the feedback, you are including this damping constant. So in a simple closed loop control system, you are expressing as G of S by 1 plus G of S into H of S. Okay. So in that fashion, you are representing here as combination of generator and load. So the turbine model has a first order lag network. First order lag network. So here your turbine transfer function is indicated as GT of S. GT of S is the transfer function of the turbine. Delta PV is change in valve output. Change in valve output. Delta PM is change in turbine output. That is mechanical power. So its transfer function is given. The governor can similarly model, which is shown in 2.7. The output of governor is by delta PG is equal to delta P reference plus delta W by R. Delta P reference is the reference set power. Delta W by R is the power given by governor speed characteristics. So the hydraulic amplifier transforms this signal into delta PG into valve position corresponding to delta PV, which is written in the form of delta PV is equal to KG by 1 plus STG into delta PG. So here you have your governor model. So you are connecting all the three blocks discussed above, the generator, load, turbine and governor blocks into the block diagram representation of ALFC, automatic load frequency control. Okay. So in the feedback path, you are considering the speed drop. So steady state performance of ALFC. So we are including either a PID controller or fuzzy logic controller to enhance the transient performance or reduce your steady state error. Okay. So for that purpose, we need to understand how the steady state performance of automatic load frequency control will be there So in the steady state, in open state, the output is obtained by substituting s tends to 0 in the transfer function. So when you are replacing s with 0, gs of gg of s, gt of s become unity, s tends to 0. So this turbine and governor transfer functions become unity values. Then the turbine output is equal to generator output, which is equal to load demand. So substituting in delta PM, delta P reference minus 1 by R into delta W. Delta PM is equal to delta P reference minus 1 by R into delta F. Either you can consider, when the generator is connected to infinite bus. Okay, when the generator is connected to infinite bus, delta F is equal to 0, delta V is equal to 0. Then, if delta F is equal to 0 in this equation, delta F is equal to 0. So delta PM is equal to delta P reference. This part is becoming 0. Suppose if the network is finite, if the network is finite, for a fixed speed changer setting. Okay, your speed is changing and your network is fixed. So delta P reference is 0. Then delta PM is equal to P reference 0, 1 by minus 1 by R into delta F. So frequency dependent load is present. If frequency dependent load is present, in that case, delta PM is equal to delta P reference minus 1 by R plus G into delta F. So in that case, it will be modified. Delta F is equal to minus delta PM divided by, if suppose P reference is 0, D plus 1 by R. So if there are more number of generators, more than one generator, then you require to include this delta PM for all the generators, all the number of generators. So delta P equivalent is evaluated using this equation, delta P reference equivalent minus D in D plus 1 by R equivalent into delta F. So delta PM equivalent is equal to delta PM1, delta PM2 plus delta PM3. So similarly, delta P reference 1 plus delta P reference 2, delta P reference 3. So 1 by R equivalent is 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3 plus so on. So the quantity beta is equal to 1, D plus 1 by R equivalent is called area frequency characteristic, which is indicating the stiffness of the system. So in this block diagram, one more additional supplementary loop is provided. Supplementary loop, this part is provided. The very purpose of including this supplementary loop is to balance the real power by adjusting the turbine output. Okay, your load demand is changing frequently. Very frequently, the load demand is changing. So you need to balance your real power generated with the load demand. So all the participating units contribute to change in generation, but a change in load results in steady state frequency deviation. So the restoration of frequency to normal value requires additional control loop called supplementary loop. That is your 1 by S into K, which is to restore your frequency to nominal value. So this objective is met by using integral controller, which makes frequency deviation zero. So the ALFC with supplementary loop is called AGC. So the block diagram of AGC is given here. So the main objective of AGC is to regulate frequency in both primary and supplementary controls and to maintain scheduled tie line flows. Okay, that is the primary objective. Secondary objective is to distribute the required change in generation among the connected generating units economically. Economically in the sense with the least cost, with the least operating cost. So here AGC, which includes primary loop and supplementary loop of your automatic load frequency controller. So the purpose of AGC is to regulate the frequency and to maintain scheduled tie line flows. That is the primary aim of this AGC. So secondary objective or secondary aim of this AGC is to distribute the required change in generation among the connected generating units economically. That is with the least cost. So how this AGC is functioning in single area? Okay, so in single area system, there will be no tie line schedule to be maintained. So the function of AGC is to bring the frequency to nominal value. So this will be achieved with the supplementary loop, which uses integral controller to change the reference power setting so as to change the speed set point. Okay, so the integral controller gain KI needs to be adjusted for satisfactory response of the system. So each generator will have separate speed governor. All the generators in the control area are replaced by single equivalent generator, and the LFC for the area correspond to this equivalent generator. So in case of multi-area in the sense here we are considering two area, which I have given you the simulation block diagram in your last class. Okay, in multi-area, two area where we are considering two areas, there will be one ALFC loop for each control area located at ECC of that area. They are combined for the interconnected system operation. For the interconnected system operation, they are combined. For a total load change delta PD, the steady state frequency deviation in the two areas is given by delta F is equal to delta W1, delta W2, which is equal to minus delta PD by beta 1 plus beta 2, where beta 1 is including your D1 R1, beta 2 is including D2 R2. So next is expression for tie line flow in the two area interconnected system. How the tie line power flow is expressed? Okay. So the steady state change in load in area 1 is indicated with delta PD1. Steady state frequency delta F is the same for both areas. Or you can consider delta F is equal to delta F1, delta F2. So in area 1, okay, PM1, delta PM1 minus delta PD1 is equal to, sorry, minus delta P12 is equal to D1 into delta F, where delta P12 is the tie line power flow from area 1 to area 2. Similarly, for area 2, delta PM2 plus delta P12 is equal to delta D2 delta F. So the mechanical power is dependent on regulation. So delta PM1 is equal to minus delta F by R1. Delta PM2 is equal to minus delta F by R2. So substituting these equations, we get delta P12 in terms of beta 1, beta 2, delta PD1. So beta 1, beta 2 are composite frequency response characteristics of both the areas respectively. An increase of load in area 1 results in frequency reduction in both the areas and a tie line flow of delta P12. So a positive tie line power is indicative of flow from area 1 to area 2, while a negative delta P12 means flow from area 2 to area 1. Similarly, for a change in area, we have the expressions. Okay. Next, frequency bias tie line control. The tie line deviation reflects the contribution of regulation characteristics of one area to another area. The basic objective of supplementary control is to restore balance between each area load generation. The objective is met when the control action maintains frequency at a scheduled value. Okay, the objective is met when control action maintains frequency at the scheduled value. Net interchange power with neighboring areas at the scheduled values. So supplementary control should ideally correct only for change in that area. If there is a change in area 1 load, there should be supplementary control only in area 1, not in area 2. Area control error, ACE is area control error, is given by delta P12 plus beta 1 into delta F. ACE2 is delta P21 plus beta 2 into delta F. So economic allocation of generation such that each generator is loaded economically. So each generating is unit is to generate that amount to meet the present demand such that the operating cost is minimum. The operating cost is minimum. This function is called economic load dispatch, which you will be learning in your PSOC in next semester. So if you have system with multiple areas, more than two areas, so generalized equation is given, which you can go through. I'll share you this video. Problems are there based on this. You can work out those problems. So ultimately, you want to control your fuzzy logic controller. Okay. In the fuzzy logic controller, what are the parameters you are choosing to control? Okay. Your error and rate of change in error, which we have seen in our last class. First thing you need to explain is your load frequency control concept. Okay, what is meant by load frequency concept? Then explain about fuzzy controller. Okay, what are the main components present in your fuzzy controller? Then you go for explaining the linguistic variables, fuzzy rules. Then the membership functions, what sort of membership functions you have chosen. These all things you need to discuss. Then only you will be awarded 7 marks. Okay. So if you have any queries, you can ask me now.